Well, Marcy, for tonight, I'd like to rent Casablanca, Citizen Kane, and this one.
Okay, these three videos.
Yeah. Could you put them in a bag for me?
Hey, Frank.
Oh, Pastor, fancy meeting you here.
Oh, Frank, we have a special on this third movie you're renting, the one entitled...
That's okay.
Hey, thanks for helping at church last Sunday.
Sure. Well, I gotta go.
Oh, Frank, you have a late charge on your last movie. It was...
I'll pay it.
I've got the title right here.
No, I'm sure you're right. I'll pay it.
So, family video night tonight.
Here's your videos. Enjoy.
You forgot the bag.
Oh, those are your videos.
Yeah, well, these two. This one's for a friend.
Oh, I see.
Well, a friend of mine's in it. I told him I'd watch it.
That movie?
Well, oh, wait. This isn't Bambi. I must have grabbed the wrong movie.
Jesus said there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known. Who are you when no one is watching? A message from Lifeline Productions. 1-800-52-FUNNY at lifelinepro.com.
Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I'll focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. There's now a sponsorship opportunity available, so if that is of interest to you, drop me a note. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that's God's guidebook for our life. So let's begin today with Psalm 33, verses 1 through 11. Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Praise the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all their host by the breath of his mouth. He gathered the waters of the sea as in a bottle. He put the deeps in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the people. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. The thoughts of his heart to all generations. Those are God's words from Psalm 33, verses 1 through 11. Our musical guest today is FFH.
When I'm down, you are up for me. When I frown, you have a smile for me. And when I'm weak, you are strong for me. You are there for me. You're always there for me. When I fall, you will catch me. When I call, quick to answer me. And when I weep, you will weep with me. You are there for me. You're always there. And follow after you.
I wanna be like you.
Speak the truth in everything I do.
I wanna be like you.
Leave the many to go and find the few.
I wanna be like you.
I wanna be like you. Thank you.
That was FFH. We'll hear from them again at the end of the program. Stay tuned for that. Turn with me as we finish the book of 1 Peter to 1 Peter chapter 5. Now as an elder myself and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as one who shares in the glory to be revealed, I exhort the elders among you to tend the flock of God that is in your charge, exercising the oversight not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you do it, not for sordid gain, but eagerly. Do not lord it over those in your charge, but be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will win the crown of glory that never fades away. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders, and all of you must clothe yourselves with humility in your dealings with one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves, keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary the devil prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith. For you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And, after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Through Silvanus, whom I consider a faithful brother, I have written this short letter to encourage you and to testify that this is the true grace of God. Stand fast in it. Your sister church in Babylon, chosen together with you, sends you greetings, and so does my son Mark. Greet one another with the kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ. Those are God's words from 1 Peter chapter 5. Recently, I received an email that explained what is reported to have happened to Mike Dowdy. He's a truck driver and was stuck in interstate traffic due to an accident that involved a fatality. This accident involved a tanker truck hauling a hazardous material load. Well, that developed a leak, which meant several hours of waiting. So he set the brakes on his truck and got out to stretch his legs. Others did the same. In the lane next to him were two elderly people in a pickup truck, which was loaded quite full. Soon the waiting people were all talking, and someone mentioned water, and Joe and Anna, that elderly couple, said they had plenty of water and sodas in the cooler in the bed of the truck and offered everyone something to eat or drink. She actually decided to make some tuna salad sandwiches for the people and asked if anyone would be interested. While Anna was making the sandwiches on the tailgate of the truck, she was singing like a songbird. For an elderly lady, she had a really good voice. She was singing that song, "I Know Who Holds Tomorrow." Do you remember that song? Do you remember the chorus? "Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand." Well, Mike noticed a Mississippi license plate on their truck, so he asked them what part of Mississippi they were from. Joe and Anna said, Biloxi. So Mike asked about the Hurricanes, and Joe said that they lost everything that they had except what was in the pickup. People offered to pay this couple for their sandwiches, but they refused. Joe said that their son was living around Harrisonburg, Virginia. That's where they were headed. He was in real estate, and he knew of an open house that they could spend some time in, but they'd have to start over, and that wouldn't be easy at their age. Now, these wonderful people that lost practically everything they owned, and still they would not accept any money for their food and drinks. And Joe said, it's better to give than to receive. They had gotten their pickup all packed up, but were delayed in the hurricane evacuations. They sought refuge behind a wall, and they watched their belongings and their home disappear in the winds and waters of Hurricane Katrina. Joe said that during that time, he had one hand holding on to Anna and the other hand holding on to God. Only their truck and they came out of Katrina unscathed. Yes, God was working. Joe and Anna are excellent examples of real Christian people who are leaders, not the false leaders too many denominations have in power. In our passage today, Peter finishes his first letter with a call about leadership. Now, Peter says that he was an eyewitness to Jesus' life, so he knows about leadership. Now, in my life, I've done many jobs. I've been a concrete builder, a heavy equipment operator, a carpenter, a painter, a laborer, a driver, a guard, a factory worker, an orderly, a nurse, a counselor, a minister, weird guy on the radio. Yes, I've worked with many different people. And throughout that, I've discovered there's a vast difference between true leadership and bosses. People can be very bossy. They boss around all sorts of things. One can boss around money. One can boss around supplies. One can boss around parts and inventory. One can boss around animals. One can boss around a herd of cattle. One can boss around a flock of sheep. But you can never successfully boss around people. You can boss around animals and stuff, but you must lead people. You can boss around things, but you must lead people. You see, people are created in God's own image and are immensely valuable. Bosses are the world's way. Bosses operate out of creating fear, but leaders inspire confidence. Bosses create resentment, bitterness. Bosses create tension and anger, but leaders breed enthusiasm. Bosses will focus on themselves. Bosses will focus on things, but leaders will focus on people. A boss might know how, but a leader will show how. Bosses make work drudgery, boring, painful, and unfulfilled. But leaders make work exciting, interesting, and rewarding. Bosses rely on coercive authoritarian power, but leaders rely on willing cooperation and the respect they've earned. Yes, leadership is for people, especially God's people. Peter knows about leadership. Jesus Christ, our Lord, says that he wants leaders for his church. He selected Peter. And as we know, God inspired Peter to write this letter. Peter tells us in verse 12 that he had a helper in writing this letter. Peter used a person named Silvanus as the secretary in writing his letter. Remember, Peter was a simple fisherman who probably was only limited in his writing ability. So God brought along Silvanus as a professional writer to whom Peter dictated his letter. Silvanus is also the minister who carried it from church to church and taught the Christians what Peter had been inspired to say. Many of the apostles used writers to help with their letters. In Acts chapter 15, Silas is mentioned. This is the same person that Peter here calls Silvanus. Silas is his Greek name. Silvanus is his Latin name. God used a multitude of ministers to help the apostles. We know of great people like Barnabas, Titus, Timothy, Tychicus, Phoebe, Junius, Nympha, Priscilla, and many others. Those godly men and women took the good news of Jesus' love and mercy to all parts of the world. Those leaders made disciples of all nations and taught the people the truth of God's word. Silvanus was one of them. So Peter addresses the leaders of the Christian church. The leaders in Christian churches have many different titles. There are deacons, elders, overseers, shepherds, pastors, ministers. One thing is abundantly clear. God wants Christian leaders to be people of loving kindness. Peter says to leaders, tend the flock of God that is in your charge, exercising the oversight not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you do it, not for sordid gain, but eagerly. Do not lord it over those in your charge, but be examples to the flock. God wants gentle, loving Christian leaders. How on earth churches can allow pedophiles to be leaders is beyond me. I would not hesitate a moment to turn those kind of people over to the police. In 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 3, we read that leaders should be above reproach, married only once, temperate, sensible, respectable, hospitable, an apt teacher, not a drunkard nor violent, but instead be gentle, not quarrelsome, and not a lover of money. In 1 Timothy 3:8, we read that Christian leaders likewise must be serious, not double-tongued, not indulging in much wine, not greedy for money. And in Titus 1:7 through 8, for a bishop as God's steward must be blameless, must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or addicted to wine or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of goodness, prudent, upright, devout, and self-controlled. Again, God gives us a list. Even in the Old Testament, God wanted loving and compassionate leaders. In Ezekiel 34:4, we read God's condemnation of abusive bosses. You have not strengthened the weak. You have not healed the sick. You have not bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strayed. You have not sought the lost, but with force and harshness you have ruled them. Does that remind you of anyone you've ever known in a church? Peter reinforces the teachings that Jesus gave. Jesus said in Matthew 20, 25 through 28, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. It will not be so among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave, just as the Son of Man came not to be served but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus also said that abusive leaders are like pigs and dogs, and that those who hurt kids should have a millstone tied around their neck and be thrown in the sea. Notice how God has told us that leaders should be good people. Christian leaders should be in ministry for reasons of integrity, not for sordid gain, not on a power trip. Indeed, greed is a terrible sin. Greed is a sin that is running rampant in far too much of the world. In a small college, a prankster made an interesting social comment. In the cafeteria line, there was a large plate filled with beautiful, golden, delicious apples. The cafeteria leader had placed a sign on the plate of apples. The sign read, "Have only one, please, and remember God is watching." Well, that prankster saw the sign and decided to make his own comment. So he drew another sign and placed it at the other end of the cafeteria line. He taped his sign to the plate of raisin cookies. His sign said, "Have all you want. Remember, God is watching the apples." Yes, far too often, people think that God is not watching and that they'll somehow get away with their sins. That's especially bad in leadership. Greed is a terrible sin, and no Christian leadership positions should be given to anyone who's greedy. Jesus said, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven." Peter is telling the church to have people of integrity in leadership positions. Peter says in verse 5, "And all of you must clothe yourselves with humility in your dealings with one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." In Zephaniah 2, verse 3, we read, "Seek the Lord, all of you humble of the land, who do his commands. Seek righteousness, seek humility. Perhaps you may be hidden on the day of the Lord's wrath." Humility is a common thread that runs through much of the Bible. Peter says, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. So what exactly does it mean to live as a humble person? A humble life is living without pridefulness or arrogance. Mary, Jesus' mom, was humble. In Luke 1:52, she sings about how God has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. So being humble is not being selfish. We should have learned that in kindergarten or Sunday school. In Matthew 11:29, Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Jesus also said, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." In Colossians 3:12 through 14, we read, "As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you. So you must also forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. That humble nature and that kind of spirit within Christians will be attractive to lost people, sometimes. But you know, a humble attitude in a Christian may look like a weakness to the world. This might be the reason why some Christians are sinning through pride and haughtiness. The truth is, humility is a divinely empowered strength. For when we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, we are protected by God's own strength. When God is for us, who can stand against us? The world still has evil, demonic forces which seek to afflict us. Satan is like a lion roaring, seeking someone to devour. And those who sin by pride and arrogance open up a doorway to Satan's torment, and they end up tormented when they sin. A 12-year-old boy wanted to have some fun and wanted to have his paper airplane have some kind of light. Well, lights and batteries were too heavy, so his way of doing it was to set his airplane on fire and then throw it. Sounds kind of like innocent fun, but his good intention was not enough. The airplane first set a hedge on fire. The fire spread from the hedge to the pool house and on to the summer home. The summer home and the pool house were burned out and two garages were charred. A police spokesman for the town said, the boy wasn't looking to start a fire. He just wanted to light his plane. Yes, even though people might have good intentions, what we do really matters. The church must resist Satan and all evil. Peter encourages us to be firm in our faith as we stand together with our brothers and sisters all around the world. For Christians everywhere will endure suffering. The body of believers is suffering in many ways. What I want to emphasize is hunger. Carolina is a devout Christian woman who knows about hunger. Carolina's in extreme poverty. She's a devout born-again believer in Jesus, but she suffers. Carolina sells scraps of junk to make money. There are no adequate jobs in the slums where she and her children live. Her husband has died. No one will hire her, so she sells scraps. But the money is seldom, if ever, enough to buy any meat. She says her children like bread, and they really like the soft bread on those rare times she can afford it. But the children usually eat the hard bread that Carolina finds in the dumpsters. Carolina's littlest child once asked her, "Mama, could you sell me to some rich people who have delicious food?" Hunger is a severe problem in those places where fires, mudslides, hurricanes, earthquakes, or whatever latest disaster has happened has occurred. Please pray for those people and consider how you can help them. But even worse than the so-called natural disasters are the evils that people inflict on each other. Christians need to stand together against the evils of the world. Denominational barriers need to come crashing down as we look in faith to Jesus, our Lord and Savior. We need to stand together. Christians of all flavors and styles. All believers in Jesus need to work together. We have so much more in common with our brothers and sisters of the faith than we do with lost people. But why won't our leaders let us work together? I'm really troubled by most denominational leaders. Church administrations above the local level are some of the most ineffective, wasteful spenders of money. I really don't understand what those denominational leaders actually do and why we're forced to pay for their salaries. They don't do personal one-on-one evangelism. They do not feed the hungry. They don't build homes for people. They don't visit the sick or the elderly. For the most part, they sit in meetings and write memos and emails to each other trying to justify their existence. That's what I consider the biggest waste of money in the world. Christians must hold leaders accountable. If a church leaders are given $100 for missions, I believe it's wrong to spend $35 of that for administrative costs. Paul was one of the church's greatest Christian leaders, and yet he never acted like modern denominational leaders. To earn his way, he made tents. In 1 Thessalonians 2:9, we read, "You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We work night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaim to you the gospel of God." And again in 2 Thessalonians 3:8, "We did not eat anyone's bread without paying for it, but with toil and labor we worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you." How big a burden is the administration of most denominations? Well, to me it's like an albatross tied around the neck of God's people. church denominational leaders are dragging a multitude of people to oblivion. In our spending, we can give room for the devil, or we can do what is right. Satan is out there roaring about seeking people to devour, but we're not united in humility and love working against evil. We're splintered into 100 different groups, all fighting in pride and arrogance over little trivial matters, while our brothers and sisters of the faith are suffering and lost people are going to hell. We need real Christian leaders. We don't need bosses. Bosses are for things of the world. We need real humble servant leaders who are living Christian examples. These leaders must show humility and a servant's heart. Then that loving and compassionate attitude will fill the churches with active believers. Then evangelists will spread out all over the land, bringing the good news of Jesus' love to people. And while this happens, we'll work to transform the world into a better place, and we'll be doing what God desires. Jesus said, "For those who do not care for the needy, eternal punishment would be the result." Jesus' words are harsh, but in Matthew 25:41-46, he said, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they will also answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So my friends, if Anna and Joe, an elderly couple who had lost everything in Hurricane Katrina, if they can still meet the needs of the people around them, why do our church denominations fail so miserably? My friends, that means it's up to you. Yes, you need to be a leader in God's church. Start leading today by helping those people right around you. I'm John Thornton. Thanks for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship and be encouraged. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. We'll finish today with FFH.
One of these days I'm gonna fly over the mountain. One of these days I'm gonna ride on the silver lining. One of these days I'm gonna witness all I've been missing. One of these days. One of these days I'm gonna do all the things that I've never done. I'm gonna finish all the races that I've run but I've never won. And I'm gonna see a million faces and recognize everyone. One of these days. One of these days I'm gonna see the hand that took the nails for me. One of these days I'm gonna hold the key to the mansion built for me. From me, and I believe I will see what it would have been if you didn't save me. One of these days, and one of these days, I'm gonna talk with all the saints that have gone before, and in their sandals, I will walk, and we will sit along the shore.